But then you say, well, what is all this religious stuff about then? Why don't we just forget it? You can try. By all means, just go away. Don't go to gurus, don't go to church, don't enter philosophical discussions, forget it. But then you'll realize that by having consented to forget it, you're still seeking. What a trap, what can you do? You see, if you stay here and listen to me or to anyone else who comes around here, you're fooling yourself. But if you go away, you're fooling yourself too. Because you still think that's going to improve your situation. It won't. And therefore, when you discover that it doesn't, you think, well, maybe it was a mistake to go away, and you come back to the guru. And he looks at you and says, you are very undisciplined, very inferior student, and you need to apply yourself. Well, as I explained what he's doing, but it comes down in a way to a sort of contest with a guru. See, will you call his bluff? You're afraid to, because you might discover that if you do call his bluff, he's no better than you are. Well, that's what you're supposed to find out. But without being cynical about it. He's as divine as you are. But you've got to call the bluff. There's going to be a showdown. And it's a double bind. The whole situation's a double bind. Because it doesn't do any good to stay here, and it doesn't do you any good to go away. Either to do something about it or to do nothing about it. When you understand that, and when you realize that there's nothing to realize, because it's all here, then what are you going to do? Well, of course, this is the sense of the Zen poem, supernatural activity and marvelous power. Drawing water, carrying fuel. So there in religion, all religious exercises, whether they are meditative or whether they are ritualistic, are whoopee. They are like art forms, like dancing. They are expressive of attainment, of the attainless attainment. Dogen said, you can't sit and meditate unless you're already a Buddha. In which case, why meditate? Well, meditation is just the way a Buddha sits. And he called this sitting just to sit, not to attain enlightenment. Because the minute you do that, you see, you're not meditating. So you only become a good meditator if you're not looking for anything. And therefore, you realize what a great thing it is to be able to sit. And what a great thing it is not to dissect the world with your analytical intellect. To be able to look out at the water or the trees or at the floor and the light on it in front of you without calling it light or floor or trees or thinking that it has parts or thinking that it's complicated. It isn't. So when you can sit without thinking, not with an empty mind, mind you, I'm going back to that point, not with an empty mind, but just a non-analytic mind, a non-probing mind, where you're not creating problems all the time by trying to control it, by trying to control your mind, by trying to control your experience, what you see and hear, you then just simply discover that there is no way of controlling what you're experiencing, because what you're experiencing is you. and to try and really fundamentally control that, this is going around in a circle. So if I were to say to you now, what you have to learn is to let it happen, that's wrong too. There's no one to let it happen. If I say to you, accept your experience, be calm and open to things, that again perpetuates the illusion that you're something different from it. So we go round and round.